Welcome to Spotlight. I'm your host, Rian Keating. Joining us today is one of New York's finest singers, a woman who has been acclaimed on both continents for her wonderful interpretations of Bertolt Brecht, Kurt Weill, and Jacques Brel, among others. We're very pleased to have her with us today. She's going to be singing, and to hear her sing is an experience so personal, so riveting, that I cannot describe it to you. Please welcome Martha Schlamme.
You who live on in towns that pass away, now show yourself some mercy, I implore. Do not go marching into some new war as if the old wars had not had their day. But show yourself some mercy, I implore. You men, reach for the shovel, not the knife. Today you'd have a roof above your head had you not gambled for the knife instead. And with a roof one has a better life. You men, reach for the shovel, not the knife. You children, that you may remain alive, your mothers and your fathers you must waken. And if the ruins you would wish to survive, tell them. You will not take what they have taken. You children, that you may remain alive. You mothers, from whom all men take their breath, the war is yours to give or not to give. I beg you, mothers, let your children live. Let them give you their birth and not their death. I beg you, mothers, let your children live. Fils de César, fils de rien, tous les enfants sont comme le tien. Le même sourire, le même alarme, le même soupir, le même alarme. Fils de César, fils d'apôtre, tous les enfants sont comme le vôtre. Son of the king or beggar's son, each little boy has land his own. Palace of gold, shack in the mud. Each little boy has his kingdom. A fading wave, a flower that cries, a bird that's dead as he must die. Son of the king or beggar's son, each little boy has land his own. Son of your son or stranger son, each little boy weeps bells his own. Son born of love or son of regret, each little boy's a poet. They lead their flock, they rule as king, they take the crown, spread their wings. Son of your son or stranger son, each little boy weeps bells his own. Son of the rich or son of no one, each little boy could be your own. Same need for smile, same need for tears, same sudden sighs, same sudden fears. Son of the rich or son of no one, each little boy could be your own.
You were born in Vienna.
Yes, a long time ago, as you know. Do you want to know about Vienna, or do you want to know anything about Vienna? Most people think it's the Blue Danube, which was never blue, you know. It was always gray, brown. I don't remember it as a happy city.
Well, you were born an only child.
Yes, that contributed to a kind of a loneliness, I suppose, because my parents were very busy with a restaurant that they had. It was a very orthodox kosher restaurant where there were festivities on Friday night and Saturday. I used to look forward to weekends or holidays when all the relatives would come from all over the world to be together.
So catered to an international clientele?
Yes, we did. And so I heard languages, you know, songs from all over the world from when I was this high. That was the jolliest thing in my memory.
And it's obviously paid off in your life today.
A little bit.
Because they were in business, did you feel shut out as a child, or?
Yes, I think so. Well, they were very loving people, actually, but they were so busy with their lives. I remember that they used to put me on a... I sang, apparently. My mother always claims that I sang before I spoke. And they would put me on a table sometimes, and I would sing the latest Schlager, that's the latest hit in Vienna, which was at the time when I was 2.5 years old, I think. Ich hab das Fräulein sehen, baden gehen, oh, das war schön. Bravo, Martha. And I used to say Bravo, Martha at the end of the song because that's what I heard other people say, and I thought that was part of the song. And then I would get a candy for singing. And I've been singing for that candy ever since, I think.
From your act that I've seen, that it's obvious that your grandfather had a great influence on your life.
Yes. Well, now, he had a really extraordinary voice. You know, he was a... Of course, he didn't use that voice to sing ordinary songs. He would use the voice for prayer. And I would get up very early on holiday time to go and hear this wonderful man. He was a beautiful looking man as well. He had a long white beard, and he was very slender, and he was very tall. And he was a funny man. I mean, he said humorous things, and he made me laugh, and he made me cry. And at the end of his life, he developed Parkinson's disease, I remember, and I would sit on his lap and hold his shaking hand and sing for him. And I don't know, maybe that's where I got this exaggerated notion of how healing my work can be. You know, the man from The New Yorker came, Brendan Gill. I mean, he didn't write it, unfortunately, because that's not his thing, you know. He doesn't write for cabaret. But he said to me, you know, you're a healer. And my heart practically stood still because I used to think of myself as having a healing quality. And then I thought, oh, well, that's just arrogance. But then when some total stranger says that to you, it's really very reassuring, isn't it? He came to one of those magical evenings, I guess. You've been at the club often. I've seen you there.
Repeatedly, I'm an incurable groupie.
That's wonderful. So there are more magical nights than others, as you know. And I think probably you were there when it was less magical as well. But he was there on one of those nights where I couldn't do anything wrong if I tried. I always think an audience has so much to do with how it goes. You know?
Well, it's obvious from... There's a wonderful Hasidic chant that you do, and it just stuns the audience. But it's obvious from this that you're very proud of your Jewish heritage. Are you devout today? Do you still practice it?
No. Proud, I don't know if that's the right word. It's like being proud that you have brown eyes. I mean, it's silly to be proud of that. It's a given. My Jewishness is very important to me because I think, as I interpreted being Jewish, it meant that you are a citizen of the world. That is not everybody's interpretation of being Jewish. I feel that being Jewish meant that you could be at home anywhere, or you better be at home anywhere, because from earliest memory, I remember my mother sitting at the edge of her seat, always. She never occupied the whole seat. And that was because someone might knock at the door and say, get out, you see. My parents came from Poland and Russia, and all they remembered was packing your little belongings and going. And so, to me, it meant adapting and adopting and assimilating and accepting other people's cultures and keeping your own intact. And I think that's why when I sing a Greek song, which you haven't heard me sing, I used to start, I was a folk singer, an international folk singer. And I would sing a Greek song and people would say, oh, was your grandfather Greek? No, not at all. Well, why are you singing Greek? Well, I love other people's heritages because I love my own so much, you see. Maybe that is called pride. It's an accepting thing, you see.
There was one incident I read where you were invited to a synagogue in Lexington, Massachusetts to sing Yiddish folk songs, and it had a very profound effect on you.
Yes, it was... the effect it had on me was... The rabbi asked me to stay through the service. And I said, if you don't mind, I won't. I'll wait outside. And he said, of course I mind. You have to sit there. You can't make a special entrance. And I almost didn't appear. And then I realized when they opened the holy book to read from it, and they said, Shema Yisrael, which means, hear ye Israel, which you know, which everybody knows, I began to weep. I couldn't stop weeping because what I saw were outstretched arms screaming to God and nobody heard them. I mean, I had visions of a concentration camp. I wasn't even there, but that was the profound vision I had. And I realized that's why I don't go to synagogue. I'm too vulnerable. I have a quarrel with my God. I cannot understand that the things that happened could happen. Well, very devout people, very religious people say, it hasn't anything to do with God. Man has a free will, and this is what he has done with what God has given him. Well, I have yet to accept that.
When you were a child and the political tension was mounting in Austria, in Vienna in particular, did your parents try and shield that from you?
I don't remember that. I don't think it was possible to shield it from you. In fact, you see what happened. There was one night when my mother and I, my father was in a camp. They had picked him up in the street and had sent him away. And my mother and I were in the house. I lived in a very large building. If you saw that building, it had four stories. That in Vienna was a skyscraper, you see. My mother and I lived on the fourth floor. And the SS, or the SR, I forget which of these devils, came in the middle of the night to burn down the little synagogue that was in the courtyard. There was a little synagogue, and they threw the books onto a pile and began to burn it, and they dragged people away. We never heard from them again, but there were non-Jews living in that building, and they were asked to come to evacuate the house, but they didn't. So there were some very decent Austrians who wouldn't let their Jewish friends die. And so I came face to face with death. And it was miraculously, the fire was extinguished and I'm here.
So but when did you escape from Vienna?
In 1938. And escape is a good word. Actually, I left the country legally. I got permission to leave. But I had no official entrance visa anywhere. So my mother, who had a permit to go and work as a domestic servant in England, you see, that's how we saved our lives. The British solved their servant problems and we saved our lives. My mother had a permit, but she couldn't put me onto her permit. But she wasn't going to leave Vienna. With me being there, she just wasn't, because that was right after that incident in the house, mm-hmm. And my father was still in the camp, and she was determined to get us all out. My mother was like, she was a tiny little woman, but she was. I always think of her as Mother Courage. she sent me to France. I had an uncle. I had an aunt who married a non-Jewish man. A Frenchman who had been a hero in the First World War. And my family, of course, was horrified because he was not Jewish. That man saved all our lives, you see, with the help of God, my father would say, of course. But he was non-Jewish, and they did not accept him at the beginning. And then I always tell that marvelous story. His children married Corsicans, And then he went into mourning, because after all, Corsicans are only horse thieves, right? I mean, the prejudice goes on and on and on. It's absurd. Anyway, he snuck me across the border. I went on a train to Kehl, which is in Germany. And he met me at the border, and at nightfall he took me across the border to Elsass-Lorraine. And that train ride was extraordinary because, well, I was 10 or 11, and I fell asleep on the shoulder of a man with a Nazi, with a swastika on his tie and a swastika on his ring. And they would, and this man gave me a candy. Of course, I don't particularly look Jewish, whatever the hell that means. I guess I could pass, but I didn't talk very much. And anyway, at home they always used to be very proud because I can sound like any Austrian, you see. So my mother was always very proud of that. And it was traumatic, I guess. The reaction to it all came much, much later. In when my mother finally brought me to England, I was in state of shock, I think. Until then, I was pretty well controlled.
Did you find the transition difficult?
I don't remember that I found it difficult. I think it took its toll. I grew up a rather neurotic young woman and have struggled out of that neurosis for a long time. I think I am most together now. In the last few years, my life has taken on I feel like a real person, and I always used to feel like a homeless citizen, like I didn't belong anywhere. That still has its place. I think that's also being a woman and being an artist and being alone.
But you do speak of assimilation, and did your parents find it difficult?
Yes, I think they found it very difficult, although my parents have now embraced England. I mean, when they came to England, and when they became British subjects, they became the most patriotic British people you could imagine. And my mother came when I got married. She came here, but she wouldn't want to live here. My father never was here. He's dead now. My mother is alive. She lives in an old age home in England, and I go to see her as often as possible. Yes, they found it difficult until, I think, the day they became British subjects. They feel more English than the English, I'm sure. They are very indebted for... They have come to rest in England. I mean, after they were interned, that's the irony of war. You see, the British were so panicked when war broke out.
Well, you were considered enemy aliens.
Enemy aliens. That's a very unfortunate term, isn't it? And to be cleared of that stigma, it took 2 years. That's British red tape.
Well, you spent the war on the Isle of Man.
Not the war, just 2 years.
Just
of it.
2 years?
2 years. The most important years, I suppose, the most... The 1940 to 1942. I was released in time for the buzz bombs. May you never know what that is. That's a bomb that's a thing that goes over your head and you don't know where it's going to drop, and then there's a stop and you think it's going to drop on your head, and it's a nightmare. But... I always thought that there was a sort of a shaft of protective shaft over my head, because I survived it all, which is just a bloody miracle.
Well, maybe that's the best way to deal with it. But when you were in the internment camp, there was a very influential man in your life by the name of Engel Lund, if I'm not mistaken.
That's interesting. Engel Lund is a woman. See, one doesn't know.
When you do your research.
They don't say that.
They don't specify, no.
No, Engel, That was a woman who came to entertain the internees. She was a very beautiful artist. She was Danish, Icelandic to be specific, but she sang a program. She came to entertain the internees. Now, I don't know if you can imagine what that's like. The Isle of Man is a very beautiful place. I came out of there with a very deep suntan because it's in the mountains and on the ocean. And she came to entertain us and sang a program called Songs of Many Lands. And her opening song, she had this tiny little accent, very much like Victor Borge, you know, that wonderful English with that slight Scandinavian sound. And she said, "I bring you songs of many lands, and I will first sing about a little girl who went out to pick blueberries for her mother. And She came home with an empty basket because she had eaten all the berries. And I mean, it's a nothing story, it's a nothing song, and there was not a dry eye in the audience. I couldn't understand. Well, I understand now. This woman brought the world into this isolation, and the humanity of this person was just extraordinary. And she influenced me very profoundly, because what there was this flash through me that said, if you survive all this, you do this to people. You better do this to people. Make them laugh, make them cry, enrich them.
And that's when it became a goal of yours to become a singer? Mm-hmm.
That's when it happened. When I was released from the camp, I went to see her. And she gave me a certificate that said to whom it may concern. And she said I deserved the best training possible, because she said I had innate gifts to tell a story. And I had good rhythm, and I had, you know, so that's how it happened, in the middle of the war.
Well, one thing Oscar Hammerstein wrote in South Pacific, which is a direct result of the war, and it may well be the reason that play won the Pulitzer Prize, is that children are taught to be afraid, to hate and fear, and yet you've gone through the war, and you've come out singing If We Only Have Love. How do you account for that? How do you account for the love that you give to people?
I think I was so blessed. I was surrounded by love amidst all that hatred. There was this Engelund who, in the middle of the war, saw to it that this penniless, homeless person got the best possible training. And they gave me a piano. And they gave me piano lessons in the middle of the war. So there were these golden people, these people for whom Abraham must have pleaded and said, look, if there's one good person left, please, God, save the world. That's how I feel, because I keep meeting these golden people, you know. And so I think I have a great deal of respect and love for people, because I think man is inherently good. It may be a mistake, but that's what I think, and I cling to it.
And it's that blind faith that you feel
his... It's called blind faith, but it's always rewarded, or most of the time rewarded. There's lots of rottenness that I've come up against, as you know, but there's mostly kindness and goodness. And I've always said, if we could just address ourselves more often to that which is good in people, we don't address ourselves to that. I mean, you turn on the bloody television and all you see is violence, and you see, get a bigger car, get a bigger house, get a bigger this. I mean, we keep addressing ourselves to not what is so good in people. Yes. So, who knows? I think maybe if we just hang on, we might create a better world. It sounds so naive, doesn't it? But I do really believe it.
But ultimately hopeful. And we do appreciate your taking time to stop by today.
Pleasure.
This is Rian Keating, and you've been watching Spotlight. Our guest today has been cabaret singer Martha Schlamme. She'll be joining us next week also, and we'll continue our discussion about her amazing career. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can write to myself in care of Perro Productions, 640 10th Avenue, New York, New York, 10036. Until next week, have a pleasant week. This is Rian Keating for Spotlight. Welcome to Spotlight. I'm your host, Rian Keating. Last week we were joined by cabaret singer Martha Schlamme, who's been acclaimed as one of the world's finest interpreters of Kurt Weill, among others. We're very fortunate that she's come back again for a second visit, and we hope you enjoy her. Please welcome Martha Schlamme.
You gentlemen can watch while I'm scrubbing the floors. I'm scrubbing the floors while you're gawking. Maybe once you tip me in, it makes you feel swell on a ratty waterfront in a ratty old hotel. You never guess to who you're talking. You never guess to who you're talking. Suddenly one night there's a scream in the night and you yell, "Who the hell could that have been?" And you see me kind of grinning while I'm scrubbing. And you say, "What the hell, she got a grin?" And a ship, a black freighter, with a skull on its masthead, will be coming in. Then you gentlemen can say, "Hey girl, finish the floor, run upstairs, make the beds, earn your keep here." And you toss me your tips and look out at the ships. I'm counting your heads while I make up the beds, 'cause there's nobody going to sleep here. Tonight, none of you will sleep here. Then that night, there's a bang in the night, and you yell, "Who's that kicking up a row?" And you see me kind of staring out the window, and you say, "What she got to stare at now?" And a ship, a black freighter, turns around in the harbor, shooting guns from the bow. Then you gentlemen can wipe off the laugh from your face. Every building in town's a flat one. Your whole stinking place will be down to the ground. Only this cheap hotel standing up safe and sound. You yell, "Why the hell spare that one?" And you yell, "Why the hell spare that one?" All the night through with the noise and to-do, you wonder, "Who's the person lives up there?" Then you see me stepping out into the morning, looking nice, with a ribbon in my hair. And the ship, the black freighter, runs the flag up its masthead, and a cheer rings the air. By noontime, the dock is all swarming with men coming off of that ghostly freighter. They're moving in the shadows where no one can see. They're chaining up people and they're bringing them to me. Asking me, kill them now or later. Asking me, kill them now or later. Noon by the clock, and so still on the dock, you can hear a foghorn miles away. In that quiet of death, I'll say, "Right now." And they pile up the bodies, and I'll say, "That'll learn ya." And the ship, the black freighter, disappears out at sea. And on it is me.
Martha, welcome back. There's an interesting story about Pirate Jenny.
Well, there are many interesting stories about Barry Jenny. Which particular one are you referring to?
It was not sung in the original production by the...
That's right. It was sung in the original production. It was sung by Polly Peachum, who is marrying Mac the Knife, and she's singing it at her own wedding. And then later on, because of Lotte Lenya, it was given to Jenny, who she's the more logical person to sing that song, although I always think it's quite wonderful when you have a gentler person, one that you do not associate that kind of attitude with. Polly sings it actually about someone else. She says, at the wedding, she says, look, I'll tell you about this servant girl in Soho. And who is, so she's singing about someone else. She's not singing about herself, you see. So it's really, when I directed Threepenny Opera, I let Polly sing it. It's more interesting for Polly to sing it, actually.
Did they insert the character of Jenny for Lotte Lenya, or was this something that...
No, Jenny was always there, but Jenny has a small part. She's an old love of McKeith's, you know, and so she just gets to sing the tango duet with him and the Solomon song, and one verse of the survival song. But when Lenya came onto the scene, I think it was right that she should sing Pirate Jenny, because no one in the world sang it like her, you know.
You've been very influenced by Kurt Weill, and you know, your names are synonymous.
Oh, that's nice. Well, actually, you know, I never met the man, unfortunately, but I feel that I know him. I met Lotte Lenya. She's dead now, unfortunately. I didn't know her very well, but we still mourn her. Her departure was just like an end of an era. But what's happening now is that my students are beginning to sing this material. Ever since the Met did The Rise and Fall of the City of Mahagoni, now Kurt Weill has become legitimized. And, and they're doing a lot of Kurt Weill all over the country. And my students sing this song and the Bilbao song. No, not the Bilbao song, I haven't yet heard. Oh, yes, someone sang it in English, as a matter of fact, in one of my classes. And somebody sang Surabaya Johnny, and it gives me great pleasure.
How long have you been teaching?
About 8 or 9 years now, and it's such an enrichment. I just love it so much.
At what point did the decision to... The decision evolved to move from performing into teaching.
Well, it was such a fortuitous, wonderful thing. You know, I'd become an actress. I don't know, you probably know that. I went from being a gentle folk singer. I was classically trained. I then sang folk songs because of the influence of Engelund, which I told you about last week. Then when I grew up a little bit, the folk song didn't have enough width or breadth for me anymore, and I began to sing all sorts of other songs, including an aria by Minotti, and I was looking for a way in which I could act more than sing. And I then became an actress and was hired at the Long Wharf Theatre in Connecticut. It was a joyous experience. I was there for 3 years and developed, and people forgot about my singing. People forget very quickly. And eventually I gave a concert there and people said, oh, she sings as well. Great. So there was a school, a high school, at the Hampden High School, and the kids were great fans of mine, particularly of mine. I don't know why, but they thought I was really all right. So they asked for me to come and speak at the school. And when that request came, I said, well, what will I talk about? I mean, I'm not a speaker. And the teacher said, oh, don't worry, they'll ask you questions and you'll answer. And I said, reluctantly, I said, okay, fine. And I got there and I was to talk for 40 minutes. I was there for 4 hours. And it was an unforgettable experience. The kids asked very provocative questions, and I just went with it. And afterwards, the woman who asked me to come said, you know, you're a born teacher. I said, oh, yeah, sure. I mean, these kids, you know, they had such respect for me because I was the star at Long Wharf, or one of the stars at Long Wharf Theatre, and also I sing. I mean, so the teacher, I will never forget that, she said, listen, for kids, you could be one of the Beatles. They'll give you 2 minutes of respect. The rest you have to earn. And you earned it. So I said, well, what do you suggest I do? She said, well, if you could come... come and give a course here.
And I said, what do you mean, give a course here? I'm a student myself. You know, I ran back from New Haven to study with Uta Hagen and go, you know, I think of myself as a perpetual student. And I think that's the secret of my being a good teacher, because I think of myself as a student, someone who has to continuously learn. Anyway, I gave that course there. They raised money. They matched funds. I don't know how that's done. And I was bitten by a bug. It's divine to teach. And I became a better performer from my teaching experience. Because, you know, I'm a very intuitive performer. And I never used to ask, why do I do this? Well, a student says, well, why do you do this? Or why do I do this? You have to come up with answers. And I don't come up with ready answers. I learned that from my great teachers, who would say, well, let's examine it. And for me, teaching has become a probing into the soul of a song, into the soul of a scene. So when a student comes with an aria, I don't say, now, this has to be done this way. So I don't know the answers. But we find them together. And what I do is I try and find their best way of serving the material.
Well, one thing you're very well known for is putting yourself out on an emotional limb. When most of the songs that you sing seem to be about the ruefulness of a woman betrayed, or so said one critic. And do you find this is true?
I sing about anything that's pertinent, I guess. No, I sing about women betraying men as well, don't I? I think. I sing about a lot of things. I sing about love and hate and friendship and joy, and I have even mock rock and roll songs. And I think what I love more than anything in the world is to make an audience laugh. And when you earn the laughter honestly, when you don't sling a pie or you don't do anything really ferocious to gain the laugh, but people are laughing with you at human foibles, it's just a divine victory. You know, when that first roll of laughter comes when I sing a song about a woman who says, I'm 6 and 40 and please take me out of pity, when people are laughing, as a matter of fact, there are people who are offended at other people laughing. They take it seriously. And I just die for that laugh. But I don't, when you ask for the laugh, you don't get it. You must not ask for the laugh. You must just do it honestly and seriously. And then they'll laugh. Or they won't. So you let it go.
Well, that seems to be a very depressing song, or so most people think.
Well, it's depressing in a way in which you can recover very quickly. It's not as depressing as war. Right?
That song was written for you, if I'm not mistaken.
No.
Come a Landsman?
No, that's an old folk song. Isn't that wonderful? I take that as a high compliment, that you think that that's my song. See, this is what I try to do, is to make the song absolutely mine, as though no one else had sung it before. When I began to sing Kurt Weill, who had written the songs, I mean, I read somewhere that Kurt had said, whenever I write something, I never write anything without hearing Lotte's voice. Oh, God, if anyone ever said that about me, it would be joyous. Well,
how did you break through that?
I put her recordings away. Well, I had a wonderful teacher who reassured me, who said, look, a composer cannot survive on one interpreter, and it has to go on. And so I took those beloved recordings, the theater songs that she made, and put them away for a year or so, which is what I tell my students to do when they love Liza Minnelli and want to sound just like her, you know. And I say, you know, an imitation of Liza Minnelli is not as interesting as you are creating the song. And the belief that you are interesting enough to put something into that song of yourself is part of my teaching, is to make people courageous enough, because people are infinitely interesting, much more interesting than they're trying to sound like, you know, like all these great singers who themselves didn't imitate. You learn from other people, obviously. You are influenced by them. But then you have to take it a step further and say, it is now my song. I am this character. I'm going to stand right inside of it and become this character. For better or for worse, as one of my teachers used to say, you die a hero's death. You just go ahead and be this character. It isn't about you, the song. I mean, that song,
pyrogeny is very far away from me. The sense of vengeance I don't have very much, as a matter of fact. So when I first began to work on that song, it was very hard for me. You know, because I don't enjoy the idea of paying someone back. But what I enjoyed the victory of her fantasy. I began to think of it as a daydream. And what I substituted for killing everyone was erasing evil, like a symbolic erasing. I mean, if I could take a gun and shoot down evil, yes, I would do that. But if there's a living person out there, I would have a great hard time to do that, you see.
When you started out as a folk singer, it's been said that you did not use a traditional banjo or a guitar. You preferred a piano.
Yes. Well, it became because of my classical training. You see, I studied Schubert and Mozart and Haydn and all those great artists. And the piano can do, and also I heard Engel Lund sing these divine folk songs. And I thought that the piano arrangements, if they are made gorgeously, as mine were and are, a piano is a more interesting instrument. I did one recording with Pete Seeger. Did you know that? Mm-hmm. Yes, oh, you know, you've done your homework, haven't you? It's a German album, and Pete plays the banjo, and that was because the recording company didn't want to use a piano. So I got Pete, and I adore it. As a matter of fact, I spoke to him on the telephone the other day. At about 40 minutes, we talked. We need to reach out to each other sometimes and talk to other artists, you see, who've survived. I mean, we are in a similar age bracket. I think he's a bit older than I am. I think so, anyway. But we are survivors from the McCarthy era and from a lot of struggle, and he survived very well also. I love the way he looks, and I love the way he sounds. And he told me that he sang one of the songs on our album in Germany because he gave a recital and they applauded. He was already in his room changing his clothes because he was dripping wet. They were still applauding. There was an ovation of 10 or 15 minutes, which happens in Europe a lot. He was going home and they're still applauding. So he came back and he said, well, I've sung myself out, but I know this song that a friend of mine once taught me. And I only remember the first line. And that audience, old and young, completed that song. It was, man, alle Brünnlein fließen, da muss ich grüßen. And that's all he remembered. You know? Isn't that a gorgeous story? I was thrilled. And they stood up and cheered and sang that old song that was just an old folk song that people grew up with. So I do sing with the guitar if there's a great artist playing it, but the guitar cannot do what Harry just did at the piano, right?
Not at all.
Those chords, although there are guitarists who can simulate them. There was great Richard Dyer Bennett who was able to do all sorts of things. And Jerry Silverman and I gave recitals together. He also was able to, I mean, almost play it. There's no substitute for the piano. And I love the instrument. I'm a pianist myself, and I adore the instrument. And I always claimed that I never destroyed the folk songs. Witness that people like Pete Seeger accepted me, and Judy Collins. Well, you saw her in my audience, didn't you? So she comes.
She's an amazing woman. She has made the transition from going from playing the guitar to the piano.
Yes, yes. Well, I love the guitar. It's a beautiful instrument, but I don't think it can do what the piano can do. Not for my stuff, anyway.
One thing you had said about Pete Seeger is that you went through the McCarthy era together. You've been known throughout your life for having an attraction to leftist causes.
Yes, I suppose you have to call them leftist causes. I prefer to call them human causes. You see, if the right took up the cause for civil rights, I'd go there. I don't care if it's left or right. I don't care who says, let's save this world from disaster. It happens always on the left. They are always the first to do that. And I found anti-fascists all over the world. They were the left, and I was very attracted, as I am still attracted to people who want to affect a difference. You see, Brecht said, change the world, she needs it. So I'm with him. left, middle, right, I don't care. You know?
What other songwriters are you attracted to?
Talk about left, Jacques Brel, who was a very ardent leftist, as a matter of fact. I'm very attracted to Sondheim, whose politics I have no idea of. I don't really care. I care that someone is committed, you know. Sondheim, I love Richard Maltby and David Shire. You know, I sing a song by Melissa Manchester. I love Murray Easton, who wrote that divine rock and roll song. Schubert, I wish I could sing him. I'm most attracted to him.
It's interesting that most of the songwriters you are attracted to mainly write about relationships.
Is that so? I suppose that's true.
And that's a lot what you sing about.
Yes, yes. I was talking to Harry on our way over here, and I was saying how I would like to create a cabaret that's called From Mozart to Weil, and everything in between. And I came up with some lovely ideas, and it will include some children's songs, for instance. That's a relationship of a child to a mother. But then what else is there but relationships? I don't sing or recite esoteric things. I don't understand them. I'm attracted to poetry that is accessible. I'm attracted to songs, the story of which I can understand so that I can relate it, you see. I'm sorry, I'm not smart enough for esoteric poetry. I love the sound of a Dylan Thomas poem, and I did it once, that said, "And death shall have no dominion." And I promise you, that was the only sentence of the whole poem I understood. And so I did it. But I mean, I didn't understand the rest. And so I've given up doing it, because I'm sure that he meant something very profound. I'm very drawn to Shakespeare. And that, if I knew how to perform a Shakespeare sonnet within my show, I'm going to do it. And I particularly love poetry. I mean, there is nothing in the world that I love more than Shakespeare. Maybe Chekhov, and maybe Shaw, and maybe Noel Coward. It's always the song I sing at the moment that I love the most.
Well, there's an interesting story you have about Shakespeare.
Yes, you mean that I was introduced to Shakespeare,
yes,
in the German language. As a matter of fact, when I was in the internment camp, I played Viola, you call her, I think, in English. I played her, we did it in German, and of course it's... They are the most marvelous translations of the German Shakespeare things. And I got used to doing Shakespeare in German. And then when I came to England, I went to see Hamlet. I was taken to see Hamlet, and I enjoyed it quite well. But I said, well, it's all right, but it suffers in translation. You see, to me, it was the original language.
Well, going back and looking at it in German, how did you find the translation?
Well, it is gorgeous in German. It really, I mean, some of, for instance, Schubert said some poetry like Who is Sylvia, or Hark, Hark, the Lark. Well, you see, that's originally in English, Hark, Hark, the Lark. To me, it doesn't sound as beautiful as the original German, which is Horch, Horch. I mean, to think of Shakespeare as the original German is funny, but you see, in every language, I have a wonderful story, which I will tell you, which I've never told in the show. Friends of mine were wonderful actors and went to the Soviet Union to do Hamlet, as a matter of fact, which in the Soviet Union is called Gamlet. There is no H. So they did it, and the Russian audience stood up and cheered for 10 minutes or 15 minutes. And afterwards, this wonderful Russian lady came backstage and congratulated my friend John Church and said, "Mr. Church, I want you to know that this was the greatest performance of Gamlet we have ever seen. And we want you also to know that in the Soviet Union, we consider Shakespeare to be our national poet." And John Church thanked her very much and said, "And I want you to know, madam, that we've never had a greater audience than you. And in England, we consider Chekhov to be our national poet." And there's this silence, and the woman says, "No, Chekhov is a Russian." I love that story. That was serious, you see. So you see, in Russia, they think Shakespeare was a Russian. And in Poland, I guess they like it in Polish. And so on.
Well, you It's not that you prefer to sing in the original language, but do you feel that your own language has gut feeling that a translation can't?
I think that's true. It cannot. It can approximate. Well, you can adapt Brecht or Shakespeare. You cannot really translate it. If you're smart, if Pasternak in the Soviet Union translated Shakespeare, then it's all right. You know, mm-hmm. because he is a poet himself, like Mark Blitzstein, who did Weil and Brecht. Yes, I think it's better in the original language. When I go to see an Italian movie, I prefer to hear the Italian sounds struggling through the subtitles. You know.
Well, Martha, it's been a pleasure.
Thank you. Our
time is up. We do appreciate your coming by. This is Rian Keating, and you've been watching Spotlight. Our guest today has been cabaret singer and actress Martha Schlamme. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can write to me in care of Perro Productions, 640 10th Avenue, New York, New York, 10036. Until next week, this is Rian Keating for Spotlight.